faith and prayer. So in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we gather here tonight. We ask that you send your Holy Spirit down upon this group. Help us be your wise disciples and to follow your ways. We entrust this day to you as together we say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Well, welcome to the 13th class of the Gospel of Luke. Lucky 13, we need your D instead of Father Scott. Father Scott is at the RCIA event, the Rite of Enrollment tonight, and so he's with all of our catechumens preparing for the Easter sacraments. So as we go on tonight, let's keep Father Scott and then our RCIA class in our prayers. We have a little bit of technical difficulties. I don't know where the clicker is or my laser pointer, so we have someone volunteer to be able to move the slideshow with us. So we'll start with our pop quiz and we can go to the next two slides. If you want to move.
It's called the Gregory College of Art.
Oh, I think we got five. Is that better?
Okay.
Yes. Yeah? Cool. If you can't hear me, feel free to interrupt me halfway through. But we'll start with our pop quiz. So we go to the next slide. And one after that. So which parable last week was meant to awaken us to the needs of those around us? Any guesses?
Lazarus
and the rich man. So if we get to the next slide, we'll see it was the parable for Lazarus and the rich man. That was Luke 16:19-31. Our next slide is the next question. What was the eye of the needle we were in about last week? What was the physical object, the eye of the needle?
It's a gate.
Yeah, it was the smaller, narrow gate inside the larger gate. And our last question is, near what town did Jesus heal the blind beggar? Near what town did Jesus heal the blind beggar?
Jericho.
Jericho, yeah. See you guys in 3 months. So, tonight in class 13, we're going to have chapter 19, verse 28, through chapter 20, verse 26. So we have a relatively small amount of time tonight. It will be a shorter class. So the first one we have is the entrance into Jerusalem. If we go to the next slide, I kind of have a map for you guys. So remember, Jerusalem's on the southern part, it's in the red area. And the next slide will give you Jerusalem itself. So we're going to start, Jesus starts near Bethpage and Bethany at a place called the Mount of Olives. So about halfway up in the map and all the way to the east side of the map is where the Mount of Olives is. It's less than a mile away from Old Town Jerusalem. So chapter 19 all takes place on the Mount of Olives and the procession into the town. So we start this entrance into Jerusalem. And Jesus said this, he proceeded on his journey up towards Jerusalem. As he drew near to Bethpage and Bethany, at a place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two disciples. He said, go into the village opposite you, and as you enter, you will find a colt tethered on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. And if anyone should ask you, why are you untying that? You will answer, the master has need of it. This is an interesting point of view, especially when we look at where the Mount of Olives is in correlation to where Jerusalem is. Like I said, the Mount of Olives is less than a mile east of Jerusalem. To a 21st century Christian, east may not mean a lot in our society today. But if we look to what the first century Christians thought of the East and what the first century Jews thought of the Eastern direction, it opens up a whole new world to us. Anytime that God is sending someone, they come from the East in the Old Testament. We see that God planted a garden towards the East in Genesis 2, verse 8. And this East was the Garden of Eden. And it's there that he placed man who he formed. So God does his action in the east. We also see in Genesis that Lot chose for himself the Valley of Jordan, and Lot journeyed to the east to go to this place. The prophet Ezekiel says that at the entrance to the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men, and their backs to the temple of the Lord, and their faces were towards the east, and it's there that they prostrate themselves towards the rising sun. Then we have this idea in the Jewish Christian tradition that the Messiah will always come from the east. The Hasidic Jews today still pray facing the east. Early Christians, up until the 20th century, typically prayed facing the east. The churches were always built facing the east. In cemeteries, people were always burying their heads facing east towards the rising sun, because it's where we believe the Lord will come again. So it's very symbolic here that Jesus is going eastward into the city of Old Jerusalem. The Mount of Olives has a lot of Old Testament references as well as New Testament references. In the Old Testament, the Mount of Olives is first mentioned with David's flight from Absalom. So David went up the ascent of the Mount of Olives and wept up there over Jerusalem. We also see in the New Testament several times where the Mount of Olives is mentioned. The ascension is traditionally held to be on Mount of Olives, as well as the Garden of Gethsemane. It's on the lower part of the Mount of Olives. So the Mount of Olives is a really rich symbol for us in our Christian tradition. Jesus had a royal entrance into Jerusalem. This marks a new part of Luke's gospel. The ministry of Jesus in Jerusalem, right before his death and resurrection, is about to begin. It quotes here a psalm that blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Only in Luke is Jesus explicitly given this title of King when he entered Jerusalem in triumph. Luke inserted this title in the words of Psalm 118 when he enters the holy city. And we'll get back to 118 in a little bit. Jesus asked them to go into the city opposite them and to find a colt tied on which no one had ever sat. This also is rich in symbolism, that a military king would ride into a city on a war horse, not a colt. Colts were typically used to be borrowed or rented for a day's journey or so. People that typically rented colts were like merchants, people who brought peace or goods about to different cities. It's interesting here that Jesus is proclaimed as a king, but he rides into the city on a colt, showing that he's going to become the Prince of Peace. He's coming not to wage war, as he would on a war horse, but rather to be a Prince of Peace in the city on a humble colt. It also is interesting they point out it's a colt in which no one had ever sat. This is a symbolism that Christ as the King is establishing a new kingdom, a throne that had not been sat upon yet. Jesus, as he enters Jerusalem, isn't going to be the same king as David was and his sons. That Jesus has that Davidic king line in him, but he's establishing a new kingdom, and this kingdom is the kingdom of heaven. This kingdom is the church. The Lord also points out that if someone was to stop them from taking the colt, they would point out that the Lord has need of him. The Lord uses us in his day-to-day ministry with others. The Lord leads us to respond generously when he calls us, and the Lord makes use of our services for the good of the church and for the good of others. Jesus was kind of rebuked by the Pharisees at the end of this gospel. And he said that the Pharisees told Jesus to rebuke his disciples for crying out, "Hosanna to the King, the Son of David." And Jesus responded to the Pharisees and said, "I tell you that if these should keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out." These stones crying out is an image of creation itself praising God. Now, it kind of sounds odd that creation itself would proclaim God as King, but we see this imagery often in Scripture. We see the hills and the sea often praising the Lord in the Psalms. that all creation is endowed with this gift from God to know who He is and know their place. So trees, hills, oceans, rivers, mountains, and valleys all praise God in Psalm 148 and also in Psalm 96. The next slide, we'll get into our next dealing, it's the Lament for Jerusalem. And I have a few pictures here to show you. And so the Lament for Jerusalem is Jesus on the Mount of Olives, and the church that was built there is called Domus Levit. I think Father Scott may have touched on this a couple weeks ago, but I think it's really important to show this again. So the next slide will show a picture of Jerusalem once again. Just to remind you that we're still about a mile to the east of the Mount of Olives. The next slide is from Jerusalem looking towards the east, and the next slide will show the church itself. And so this is the church of Domus Levit, or the church upon where the Lord wept. It was designed in the 20th century to specifically look like a teardrop to remind us that the Lord shed tears here. This is a window that it was originally stained glass, and they replaced it with clear glass, so you can see from the church the city of Jerusalem itself. And there might be one more picture of the church up there. Yeah, and so this last image for this is an artist's rendition in the 18th century to show us the Lord's view of Old Town Jerusalem. So today, if you go to Jerusalem and go to the church of Domus Levit, you would see the gold domed mosque. Of course, that wouldn't have been there in Jesus' time. So this kind of gives us a better idea of his vision of Old Town Jerusalem at this place. For when Jesus drew near the city, he saw the city and wept over it, saying, "In this day you only knew what makes for peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. For the days are coming upon you when your enemies will raise a palisade against you. They will encircle you and hem you in on all sides. They will smash you to the ground and your children within you. They will not leave one stone upon another, because you did not recognize the time of your visitation." This kind of doom and gloom of this part of Jesus weeping over Jerusalem. One of the most important things to realize here is that as Jesus approaches the final week of his life, he knows that he's going to die on Calvary a week later. But he's not weeping for himself as he approaches Jerusalem. He's rather weeping for Jerusalem itself, saying they're not recognizing the time you're about to enter. They're not recognizing that God will come upon them to visit them. They don't know what makes for peace, and so there will be the sword. They don't choose Christ, the Lamb of God, who brings about peace. This cry was that of a frustrated desire. He had visited the city several times in his life with much desire to convert them. But the result was inevitable. There was no escape from this destruction. And the destruction that Jesus is kind of referring to is the siege of Jerusalem in 70 AD. So he's referring to an event about 40 years after his own death, when the Romans come and pillage the city, that they don't leave any stones on top of other stones in this pillaging 40 years later. So Jesus is saying, if you had known what made for peace, this could have been spared. Then we can take this as Jesus actually predicting the siege 40 years after his own death, or we can say that Jesus is talking about a spiritual siege that not accepting Christ causes in our own lives. That when we don't follow the ways of God, we don't have peace. And if we had known Jesus, we would have had peace. So Jesus weeping in this time is really for the Jewish people. This is also another triggering event for the Jewish people. Their leaders have rejected Christ time and time again. And if they had known his work as the Messiah, they could have been spared the destruction to come in their own lives. They could have avoided the lack of peace they have in their own lives. The prophet Daniel also talked about the day of the Lord coming, and he mentioned that this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. That we can rejoice and be glad in it because we know Christ is the Messiah, and we follow his will on earth. When Jesus mentions the things that he made for peace, it's also a play on the word Jerusalem itself. Jerusalem means the city of peace, but it's in this very city that we will commit the greatest sin possible when we kill our Lord and King, when we kill God. The desire for this political Messiah who would overthrow the Romans so blinded the Jewish people of the time that they weren't able to see by rejecting God himself, they were bringing total destruction in their own lives. It's right from this event that we go into the cleansing of the temple. The cleansing of the temple is when Jesus entered the temple area and proceeded to drive out all those who were selling things, saying to them, "It is written, my house shall be a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves." And every day he was teaching in the temple area. The chief priests, the scribes, and the leaders of the people, meanwhile, were seeking to put him to death. But they could find no way to accomplish their purpose because all the people were hanging upon his very words. So in this temple area, Jesus calls them a den of thieves, that he drives out the buyers and sellers in the court of the Gentiles. Berkeley, who was a historian, said that a pair of doves at this time would have cost about 4 cents outside the temple, but it could have cost as much as 75 cents within the temple itself. That's almost 20 times more than its value. Jesus' anger here is towards those who are selling and those who are buying the temple area. The doves they would have sold in the temple would have been used for a sacrifice. And people extorting the people of God to make a profit off of the sacrifice prescribed by the law. That Jesus is saying that you're treating my house of prayer into a den of thieves. That where the selling took place in the temple was in the court of the Gentiles. It was the only place where non-Jews could go into the temple and try to pray. But with the buying and selling of these goods, it turned into a marketplace. And so a place that should have been a house of prayer that was quiet and peaceful became a busy marketplace where people were doing daily business, disrupting each other's lives and trying to haggle with one another. That this wouldn't have been the best place for those who were trying to figure out what truth was about coming to God. These Gentiles who didn't believe the monotheistic God was disrupted by this. It's also very unique here that it says that after Jesus banished these people from the temple, after they drove them out of the temple, that he began to teach there every day. So after running merchants out of the temple courts, Jesus here continued to boldly continue his work of public teaching and healing. He was able to do this because the people wanted to hear them. It says that they were clinging to the very words of Christ here. This ends chapter 19 and moves right into chapter 20. With chapter 20, right after it says the people were hanging on to the very words of Christ, we hear the chief priests questioning the authority of Jesus. So one day, while he was teaching the people in the temple area and proclaiming the good news, the chief priests and scribes together with the elders approached him and said to him, "Tell us, by what authority are you doing these things? Or who is the one who gave you this authority?" He said to them in reply, "I shall ask you a question. Tell me, was John's baptism of heavenly or of human origin?" They discussed amongst themselves and said, "If we say of heavenly origin, he will say, why did you not believe him? But if we say of human origin, then all the people will stone us, for they were convinced that John was a prophet." So they answered that they did not know where it came from. Then Jesus said to them, "Neither shall I tell you by what authority I do these things." Now it's important to know in this gospel that Jesus here isn't starting these debates with these religious leaders. These scribes and Pharisees were trying to question Jesus to kind of put him in a sticky situation. That they ask him, "What authority do you have to do these things?" Jesus already has shown great courage by going into Jerusalem, kind of overthrowing the religious ideas of the time of selling them in this marketplace, and kind of questioning the traditional rabbinical teaching that these scribes and Pharisees would have said, well, I went to rabbinical school. I'm teaching with the authority of Moses because I'm teaching what Moses taught. The scribes and Pharisees at the time would never say what their interpretation was. They were always trying to quote someone in the past and say, it's this person's authority. It's the prophet Ezekiel's authority. And they're kind of questioning Jesus, saying, you're giving us these teachings, but by who are you giving these teachings by? And they try to trick Jesus into saying that he's coming from God directly. And Jesus, quite wisely, responds back with a question to trap them in their own ways. That he responds by saying, what's the origin of the baptism of John? By responding to the question, he explained who he is and his purpose, but he also pointed out the hypocrisy of the leaders. For if John was from God, he was right in proclaiming that Jesus was the Messiah. And if this were true, Jesus had all the authority he needed. But they didn't believe that. They were men who were more concerned about their authority and their power in the temple. That Jesus knew where they were coming from. And these men weren't real seekers of the truth. They weren't interested in actually learning where Jesus' authority came from. They were more interested in winning an argument and trying to get Jesus out of their place of teaching. So when they question that and say, well, I don't know where it came from, you see their reason. They're not saying that they believe where John came from. They don't even seem to care about that. For they answer, well, if we say that John's authority is from God, it means Jesus is the Messiah. And if we don't say that John's authority came from God, then people will stone us. They weren't interested in what the truth actually was. They were interested in keeping their own positions. And so Jesus said that neither will he tell you where his authority comes from. That Jesus has compassion on all those he meets in the scriptures, and it seems except for those who are Pharisees. But Jesus, knowing their hearts, knows that he's going to go after those who seek the truth. He's not interested in people who are trying to promote their own self-good. And so Jesus kind of refuses to answer because he's going to have compassion for those who seek the truth sincerely. This is still true today, that Jesus has given us a vast treasure of knowledge within the church, and it's for those in the church who are asking questions about how can I learn this, what can I do, that Jesus tends to give the most compassion to in our daily lives. Our next parable is the parable of the tenant farmers. Jesus proceeded to tell the people a parable. A man planted a vineyard and leased it to tenant farmers. And there, he went on a journey for a long time. At harvest time, he sent a servant to the tenant farmers to receive some of the produce of the vineyard. But they beat the servant and sent him away empty-handed. So he proceeded to send another servant. But him also they beat and insulted and sent away empty-handed. Then he proceeded to send a third, but this one they too wounded and threw out. The owner of the vineyard said, what shall I do? I shall send my beloved son. Maybe they will respect him. But when the tenant farmers saw him, they said to one another, this is the heir. Let us kill him, that the inheritance might become ours. So they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. What will the owner of the vineyard do to them? He will come and put those tenant farmers to death and turn over the vineyard to others. When the people heard this, they exclaimed, let it not be so. But he looked at them and began to quote scripture. I'll stop reading right here and I'll come back to that in a minute. So the parable of the landowner and his tenants is the story of creation. That this earth belonged to God, he formed it and created it. And then he created the first humans, Adam and Eve, and gave them dominion over the land and the creatures. That we're here as tenant farmers in this world. That all we do will go back to the Lord. This idea of tenant farmers Mars was something very familiar to the first century inhabitants of Jerusalem. The tenant farming is a very popular thing to do. That when the vineyard is planted, the parable has more than just its cultural connection. Like I said, it's rooted in the very Old Testament. Vineyards were something often used in the Old Testament to describe the work of God because it takes many people. It's leased to the vineyard workers. They didn't buy the vineyard. They didn't make it. They were allowed to work because the owner was generous to them. Now, when the servants are beaten, the vineyard owner says, "What should I do?" And he says, "I'll send my beloved son." That should immediately perk up our ears and say, who has been described as the beloved son in every gospel? And it's Jesus Christ. This is God the Father saying, they're not treating my prophets well. They're rejecting the prophets. They send them away from what they're preaching, and they don't want to hear the word, the message that God is trying to give them. And so he sent his own son into the world, knowing full well that we would reject the son, that we would kill the son, and try to receive his inheritance, which is life with the Father. That Jeremiah summarizes that a farmer may have assumed from the arrival of the son that the owner had died. So if they killed the sole heir, the vineyard was passed into the hands of the people who worked the vineyard. This parable tells us that Jesus knew his identity as the Son of God, and that he knew that he would be killed very soon. So when they heard this and said, "Certainly not, don't let this happen," the religious leaders here understood the parable immediately, that they were rejecting someone who was the Son of God. And Jesus had compared them specifically to the rebellious and the foolish tenants. That they spoke in their blindness and kind of in their arrogance that this could never be us. Jesus then quoted Psalm 118 when he says, "The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone." That this cornerstone, this foundation of the new kingdom, would be Jesus Christ himself. And he's predicting here that he's going to be rejected by the tenants, by the tenant farmers of the church of the Jewish people. This Psalm 118 is also used a lot in the Easter season because it portrays Israel at the triumphant entry of the Messiah. It says, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We will bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God and has enlightened us. Join in procession with leafy branches up to the horns of the altar." Just a short few days before Jesus gave this parable, that's exactly what we did. We laid palm branches on the road as he entered on Palm Sunday in Jerusalem. The palms here are a symbol of martyrdom. That we often see depictions of martyrs holding a palm branch, showing that they witnessed their lives, even to death, for the truth that God gave them. That Jesus was greeted with these palm branches on his way to Jerusalem and on his way to his death. And the last parable that we'll go over today is on the next slide. It's paying the taxes to the emperor. They watched him closely and sent agents pretending to be righteous who were to trap him in speech, in order to hand him over to the authority and the power of the governor. They posed this question to him, "Teacher, we know what you say and teach is correct, and that you show no partiality, but teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. Is it lawful for us to pay tribute to Caesar or not?" That part of the issue with this is we know from the last parable that the scribes and Pharisees weren't interested in the truth. They weren't interested in recognizing if Christ was the Messiah. They just wanted him out. And so they're here sending agents to pretend to be righteous. Then we're going to trap him in speech, try to corner him to a corner saying that we can't pay tribute to Caesar, we can't pay taxes. And through this, he would be put to death on the government's behalf. Then they say, "Teacher, we know what you say is right, and you don't have partiality, and then you teach it the way of God. This is an obvious and clumsy attempt to influence Jesus with flattery. They hoped that Jesus would be insecure in his identity and his mission from the Father. And when they asked, is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? This dilemma and question is simple. If he said that taxes should be paid, he could be accused of denying the sovereignty of God over Israel and not the Roman people. And if he said that we should not pay taxes, he would make himself an enemy of Rome. Jesus responds to their questions by saying, why do you test me? Show me a coin whose image and inscription does it have on it. Then on the screens we have an image of a coin that they would pay the taxes on, and on it is an image of Caesar that we know. That in Jesus' time, this would have been Tiberius Caesar, and the inscription on the coin, which is Latin and kind of hard to read because it's an old coin. What is that in English? Tiberius Caesar, a son of the divine Augustus. These images on these ancient coins are making a claim that the Caesar, the man in charge, is a son of God. And so they're proposing that the son of God should be against the Romans who are claiming he was son of God. Jesus, after he says this, says, render therefore to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. Jesus affirmed that his government can have a legitimate claim and requests us, that we're responsible to God in all things, but we also must be obedient to governments in matters that are civil and national and in accordance with God's law. That it's in accordance with God's law that a government can tax. And so it's okay to pay taxes is what Jesus is saying. A lot of theologians actually kind of chuckle at this gospel when we talk about the United States and the Christian way of life. And I'm not going to get political here by any means, but a lot of theologians point out that it says about our currency, in God we trust. And kind of how our founding fathers wanted to repress this idea on us, that it's not in our personal wealth that we should put our trust, but rather in God. And the theologian kind of chuckled because how many Americans today really do believe that it's in God that they trust and not in their own wealth? That this was the founding fathers maybe trying to Christianize our understanding of money and kind of help us to better understand. Now, when we say that to render to God the things that are God, we can kind of say, well, what is that? What does that mean to us? That we know here that everyone has an image of God impressed upon their soul, that we're wondrously and lovingly made by our God, and we can see our God's kind of impression in every human being, particularly amongst those who are baptized, that when we're baptized, we receive an erasable mark on our soul that configures us to God. And so when Jesus says to render to God what belongs to God, he's saying that the image stamped on every soul indicates that we ourselves belong to God. That this is Jesus saying that we should give our lives back to God the Father because we do belong to God. On the back of your handout, I put an excerpt from Archbishop Chaput's book, Render to Caesar. It's serving the nation by living our Catholic beliefs in political life. But I believe this excerpt was written in about 2014, but really, and it says the date on that, but really this book was published in 2009, and this is someone taking kind of the gist of the book and putting it in a short page to read. So if you're interested in seeing how we can render to Caesar what belongs to Caesar and God what belongs to God, I do highly suggest Archbishop Chaput's book. And that actually ends our lesson for tonight. So are there any questions before we go to the small groups? I know I kind of went through that fast. Yeah.
More of a comment, question. Over and over from the time of the Annunciation of Luxembourg to something that not Bishop Donald mentioned this ago. Which Paul shared about transformation Mary Baptist. And at other times, we continue to talk about where someone is transformed. There's an element, it seems to me, that is more passive. It's not right to say passive, but my non-Catholic Christians talk about transformation as though it's something that you feel as a sensation. However, it seems to be consistent, for example, with infant baptism, that there is then something transformed in spite of what they feel, which is probably just cold water for them.
Sure. Well, it's with that, as you say, that Catholic transformation, that we have to give the consent in our baptism. And most of us have baptized infants. Our parents gave that consent of faith. And so it's important when we renew our baptismal promises, we really do need our consent there. That liturgy means work done on behalf of the people. And so God is the one who does the work. God is the one that transforms our souls. But He always does that with our consent. So yeah, that's a good point. Thank you. Any other questions or comments before we read these numbers? Well, great. Thanks for bearing with me tonight. I'm excited to say Father Scott will be back for the next one, so we'll move back to the 18 next time. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.